taxes, whatever way you want to communicate with your elected officials. But I saved the best for last. You get to vote with your dollars to reward those people that are doing good things by the environment or other issues that you may care about. But you vote for those people and companies that are doing a good job, and you support them, and you withhold your dollars from companies that are doing bad things. And that vote is very, very potent. It's very important. So it's important that people vote in every way, and not the least of which is voting with your spending.
Why should I recycle?
You should recycle because people regularly talk about throwing something away. Honey, throw this away. Sweetie, would you please throw this away? I want somebody to tell me where away is. There is no away. Landfills serve us the way the portrait served Dorian Gray, to cavort in this orgy of consumerism till the final day of reckoning, which is today or yesterday, depending on where you live. It's today if you live next to a landfill. So somebody else's backyard is usually where a landfill is, and most people don't want it in their backyard, and that's why they say throw it away. We have to recycle every single thing we humanly can, and that needs to start now. Eliminate waste.
You say all this, but why is it so important?
It's very important for our children and grandchildren to have a habitable planet, to have something resembling the kind of life that we had as young people, to have some of the wild and scenic places, to have some of the exposure to and the interaction with many plant and animal species. And we need it for our well-being. You know, you can't lose a certain number of plant and animal species and continue to survive. There's disagreement over where that number is, where that threshold is. Some people think we're going to be fine if we keep doing this for a while. Some people think that day of reckoning is tomorrow or today, but we have to value the web of life. It's why we get to sit here talking on camera and watching this video. We do it because there are more people that were environmentally conscious than not, or we wouldn't be here. That's why I sit here today clothed and fed and hydrated, because even with all the damage that's been done, there's been more good than bad, or I wouldn't be here. We would have already degraded the environment so bad I wouldn't be sitting here in relatively good shape. So we have to make sure that there's enough left for our children and grandchildren that they can do the same. And we have to move quickly because there's tremendous compromises to the environment, starting with climate change, the amount of plastics in the ocean, the acidification of the ocean, the loss of our coral reefs, the loss of many other species. These are real warning signs, and we have to make a change in our behavior now, or we're going to really hand something to our children that they will question us about.
So, you're a tree hugger. You're just a tree hugger. This is propaganda.
Well, I am proud to be a tree hugger. Trees are an important part of our well-being as a human species. We're attracted to trees in any number of ways, and it's propaganda that is embraced by NOAA and NASA and National Geographic and many other people that I trust. So I would recommend that people go to any, you know, peer-reviewed study and get information about climate change or loss of coral reefs or acidification of the oceans. I will roll those dice, because if they go to a peer-reviewed website or just go to a college campus where there are people there on that college campus who actually know what they're talking about, and talk to somebody with the important letters PhD after their name, they will get good, reliable information, and they will see that it's not propaganda. It's the facts as reviewed among peers in the scientific arena.
Isn't this someone else's job to clean it up? I didn't make the mess.
Well, sadly, I can't say that. I am somebody who was part of the mess until I kind of woke up at age 20 in 1970. I was part of the generation in the 50s and 60s that made a lot of the mess. I mean, it's not like I was a litter bug or anything. I wasn't flagrant, but I drove a normal kind of a car, and I had a Mustang at about age 18, and I drove it around and thought it was just fine. I didn't understand or want to understand the connection between that Mustang and the smog in LA. I quickly figured it out by 1970. I started to hear about some of the reasons why we had smog and the reasons we had other problems in the Pacific Ocean, the amount of pollution in the Santa Monica Bay, I started to see my role in it. And I set about making that better. I set about making the air in LA better. And as I said, even though we have four times the cars in the LA area since 1970, millions more people, there's a fraction of the smog. The Santa Monica Bay, much cleaner than it was in 1970. We all did that together. I had a small role in it. Many people had a majority role in it, but we did it. And the economy did not suffer. We all prospered.
This won't affect us in our lifetime. Why should we care?
We should care because it really is a health issue. We want to lead a healthy life ourselves. We want to have clean air to breathe and clean water to drink, and we want it for our children. The environmental movement is really a health movement, in my opinion. We want to be healthy. We want our kids to be healthy.
What else would you like to say if you were to send a message to the world, and if you were to be remembered from this moment in time, what's that moment that you hope people remember most?
I would urge everybody to live simply so that others can simply live.
And what about differences versus similarities?
Yeah, look for those similarities. Reach out to your friends and neighbors, even though they might be the other side of the aisle from you, and see if there's common ground. And I think many times you'll be able to find it. There's people who care about their children. They care about the web of life. They may not even use those terms, but they care about nature or the great outdoors or whatever way they frame it. But reach out and try to work with people instead of fighting them.
What if I'm seeing this film right now and I'm oppressed by my religion or my government, that I must hate other people or I must do things that contradict what I'm hearing here? How do I deal with that? How do I empower myself?
That's a big, tall order. There's, a whole hour that could be devoted to overcoming, religious bias towards others, the way we view others, we in this country, in the United States, view others, the way people in other cultures and other religions and other parts of the world view us. There's a tremendous amount of bias, and that needs to be overcome. There's fortunately some relief in that area. There's something called the Interfaith Coalition on the Environment, where people of many different faiths come together and try to find common ground in protecting creation, protecting the earth, protecting what God has given us. And I think that gives me hope that there are people, such people, who look beyond religious boundaries and are trying to do something together.
So, and I know you're pressed for time, so I'll wrap here. So you know that there are people that think that this is all a Hollywood stunt, that Americans have over-cannibalized the planet, now we don't want the rest of the nations on the world to do the same. Why should they have to not have the quality of life that all Americans had when we lived in the life of excess?
That's a very good point. People in the developing countries are wondering, why are you telling us not to burn high sulfur coal? We happen to know how you built the Brooklyn Bridge and the Empire State Building. You built it with high sulfur coal. Why are you telling us that we can't, make steel the way you made it? There's all sorts of things that we've done that we're saying to people in other parts of the world, don't do it that way. Well, you can view that as being, selfish, and now that I've got mine, don't do it that way. But you can also look at it by way of us sharing technology, where they can leapfrog over the old technology and go right to things like solar and wind and geothermal, and not be stuck in the old Industrial Revolution way of doing things, but to be forward thinking and to do as much renewable energy as you can. Because they're seeing the cost of it now in cities like Beijing. They have such a problem with air pollution in Shanghai and Beijing, and in Mexico City and in Bangkok and many other parts of the world. They have tremendous loss of work and productivity from air pollution. So they're seeing a bottom line effect of dealing with things the way we did. So maybe they'll be open to doing things different, and they will employ some of the technologies we've come up with, and we will happily export them to them, and they can have a cleaner lifestyle and some of the same quality of life thresholds as we've had.
So we're in the industrialized nation, and we're telling the rest of the world, do it our way. Isn't this because we're trying to promote our own new green technologies and it has nothing to do with the environment whatsoever? This is all just a stunt to sell new ideas?
There are people who are certainly out just to sell, you know, a technology and reap a profit. And I have no problem with that, that those people work side by side with people that have more altruistic views, because the end game is that you get people to employ them for capitalistic reasons, fine by me. You know, people are starting to see that a lot of the efficiencies you can build into a building are good for your bottom line if you're in it for the long haul. And more people are looking at things long term. You know, when you consider the cost of building a building, the cost of building it, the cost of that building really is like an iceberg, the kind of iceberg where there's a little tiny piece, a little triangle that's up above the water, that little tiny slice like that. But the biggest part of the iceberg is below the water, that huge chunk, that's the cost of running the building. The cost of building is that little piece. So if you invest in good technology to make an efficient home or building, the cost of running it over that life of the building over hundreds of years is very, very low. So if you're forward thinking at all, it can be very good for your bottom line. You can be energy independent and very quickly be into profit and very quickly have low, low bills. Yeah, let me
get that. I'll stop. Thank you.